Welcome to the BioWolf Bash scripting class. In this section, we will extend what we have learned in the input, output, and redirection section to cover Bash pipes, including name pipes and process substitution. If you're not familiar with redirection, I suggest watching our section on that topic first. But I will begin with a quick recap. When a command is run, that is, when a process starts, it can interact with the user through three standard channels, standard input, standard output, and standard error. In an interactive shell, these are configured in such a way that the standard input listens to the user's keyboard, while standard output and error display messages on the user's screen. But in the background, these are all just device files. As a result, that opens up the possibility of redirecting the three streams to and from files. A process can take input from one file, write output to another file, and write any errors to a third file. Redirection is further adapted into a shell feature called pipes. Here, running commands can interact with each other in a specific way by piping the standard output of one process to the standard input of another. This is done without the user having to set up explicit redirection to any intermediary files. The only thing the user has to do is place a vertical bar character between the two commands, like so. And this is not restricted to only two processes. One can easily string multiple commands together if needed. A less common situation is if one wants to redirect both standard output and error of a process to another process's standard input stream. To do that, you can use the vertical bar and ampersand characters together without a space in between. Of course, it is possible to redirect the remaining streams in the pipeline to or from files. Let's see how pipes work in action and how they can be useful to us. On the way, we will also learn about numerous commands useful to anyone working with Bash. Here we are logged into BioWolf. Before I begin, I will start an interactive session so that the login node isn't affected by any compute-intensive calculations or perhaps mistakes I make. We'll use the sinteractive command to start an interactive session. This command is specific to the BioWolf cluster. You can see its help documentation using the -h flag. But here we will use all the default settings, so simply typing the command and hitting enter will work. We'll wait for the job scheduler to set us up with an interactive session. I'll skip this wait time when I edit the video. Alright, here we are on the interactive session on BioWolf. To understand Bash pipes, we will use some sample genetic variant data, presented as a table in a single file. Let's explore this file first. It is called sample_data.txt. The data we receive relates to genetic variants in a sample. Let's look at the contents of the file with cat. That prints a lot of lines of text, which isn't really helpful. I'll clear the screen. Instead of cat, let's use a new command called head. Looking at its manual, it informs us that the command prints by default the first 10 lines of the file to standard output. Let's try out the command. We first quit the manual with the Q key, then we run the command head on our sample data file. That seems more manageable. Here we see 10 lines of tabular data. The first line looks like the header row with the column names. From the structure of the data, it looks like that each variant in the sample, identified by the ID column, has been associated with multiple gene features, mostly transcripts, in a single gene. And then the variant is classified into a variant type, along with possible information on the variant's impact. Let's try to find out what are the different values for the variant classification column. Right now, we see only three types. To accomplish this task, we have to figure out how to exclude the header row, to extract only the variant classification column from the file, and finally to pull out only the unique values. Let's start with capturing the header row. The only thing that separates it from the data is that it starts with the pound or hash symbol. The data rows don't. For this purpose, we can use the grep command. Here's the manual. Grep prints lines that match a pattern. Let's try matching the pound symbol. Great! Grep printed all the lines that include the pound symbol. In our case, that is just the first line. Now instead of selecting that line, we want the rest of the line. We can do that using the -v flag to grep, which inverts the match. I'll bring back the previous command using the up arrow, then add the -v flag. But before I hit enter, note that this will likely print hundreds of lines to screen. You don't really want that. So let's create our first pipe. We will take the standard output of grep and pipe it into the standard input of head. This will print 10 lines from the file that do not include the pound symbol, which really just means we're excluding the header row. Great. Now we need to extract the variant classification column. For this, we will use the cut command. Here's the manual. We can use the hyphen F option to extract the column we need. The option requires the column number or numbers we want to extract. Let's exit the manual and find the column number of the variant classification column. It looks like it is the sixth column. Now we'll use our grep command that excludes the header row, pipe it to cut, and finish the pipe with the head command to get a reasonable output. Good. We have now extracted the data in the variant classification column, excluding the header row. The next step is to get the unique values. This is a two-step process. We will first sort the values in the variant classification column. Bash provides us with a sort command to sort lines of text. Let's bring back our last pipe and add sort. Here we see a different set of values as before, which would indeed show up first when sorted. Now the second step is to get the unique values with the unique command spelled UNIQ. Again, we will add that to our pipe, but this time I will remove the head command at the end so that we don't just report 10 unique values. Good. With our pipe containing four commands, we have successfully figured out the types of variants we have in our data. Now we can redirect the output to a file to save it for future use. We can also use the last unique command in the pipe to give us a count of each variant type. This is done with a hyphen C flag. Let's try that. Okay, if we want to see this final aggregated data ordered according to the counts, we can pipe that to sort again and give it the N flag to sort numerically. I hope that gave you a good introduction to bash pipes. But why use pipes to begin with? Apart from the obvious convenience of combining several operations into one command line, the biggest advantage is that intermediate output does not have to be written to disk, which can be an expensive operation. Another advantage is the subsequent processes in a pipe start working on the incoming data as soon as it is available instead of waiting for the previous process to finish. In a way, the processes start running in parallel and do their processing in parallel. Let's move on to name pipes. These are pipes created using special files. These files use the file-in, file-out concept where multiple processes can write to or read from the named pipe. Usually, to see how named pipes work, one needs separate sessions or shells, but there are workarounds which I will show in the next demo. Named pipes have the same advantages as regular bash pipes. Nothing is actually written to disk, and processes writing to and reading from the named pipe can run simultaneously. That begs the question, why use named pipes? Their use really shines when we have processes that write out or read from multiple streams of data, often over a long period of time. Here's an example. Say we have input data in a file that is processed by a program called command1, which creates three output files. We also have a second program, command2, that can read inputs created by the first program to give us some consolidated result in a single file. A regular pipe won't work here because the first process writes out multiple streams of data, and the second one reads in multiple streams as well. This is where named pipes can come in handy. We create three named pipes with the make FIFO command, then pass those as outputs to command1 and inputs to command2. This way, the intermediate files previously called sample1, 2, and 3 are not created. No data is written to disk. Also, command2 can start processing data as soon as it is available through the named pipes. By the nature of this example, it is not easy to demonstrate right now, so let's just look at how a named pipe is created. We will use the last pipe we created to demonstrate how name pipes work. Let's first create a name pipe with make FIFO. Let's see what that looks like with ls. As you can see, the name pipe F1 has been created. For this demonstration, I will start a background process that reads from the name pipe, sorts the output numerically, and writes it out to a file sorted.txt. Now we will bring back the last pipe we ran on sample data.txt that showed us the counts for each variant. you will redirect the output of unique-c to the name pipe. If I hit enter again, I get a message from the shell that our background process, which would sort anything that appeared in the name by my fun, has completed. So let's confirm and print the contents of the sorted.txt file. Behind the scenes, the background sort process was running and waiting for text to appear in its standard in channel. The standard in was actually the name pipe F1. Then we ran our pipeline, which started a series of processes that redirected their standard output into the name pipe F1. So as soon as the text appeared, the background process sorted the text and redirected it to the sorted.txt file. It was instantaneous because the data is very small. Good, that gives us a quick demo of how name pipes work. We can delete a name pipe using the rm or remove command. Now let's talk about process substitution. This feature is very similar to name pipes, but does not have the special FIFO file in the middle. Process substitution can come in handy when we are putting together a pipeline where standard output from multiple processes become the multiple input streams required by a single second command. Let's see this in action. For this demo, we will again use our sample data.txt file. And we will try to compare the types of variants our sample has on two genes, say gene 10 and gene 11. We can use much of the same pipeline we created previously, but we will change the first grep command to select only the lines that match gene 10. And we don't want to focus on count, so we will remove the hyphen C flag to unique. The same can be done for gene 11. Of course, we can manually compare the two outputs, but instead, let's use the com command. I'll print out the manual as always. This command compares two sorted files. Without any flags, the manual states that it will produce three columns. First one shows lines unique to the first file, second to the second file, and the third column shows lines shared by both files. Let's try that. However, instead of files, we will use process substitution. This will be quite a long command line, but let's give it a shot. I will use my terminal emulator's inbuilt copy-paste mechanism to help us out. Paste here. Paste here, and now we can run it. So here are the three columns. The first is for gene 10 and the second for gene 11. The third is the intersection between the two. We can also zero in on one or two of these columns using the suppression flags, minus 1, 2, or 3. Let's suppress columns 1 and 2 to show the third column. This gives us a clear picture of which types of variants our sample has that are common between gene 10 and gene 11. We were able to accomplish this with pipes and process substitution. To summarize, in this section of the BioWolf Bash scripting class, we extended our knowledge of redirection to cover bash pipes, name pipes, and process substitution. Here are the commands I use in this section that I haven't shown before. Feel free to pause the video and read through the slide. As always, if you have any questions or comments, feel free to email us at staff@hbc.nih.gov. One last thing, make sure to exit out of your interactive session and free up the resources for your BioWolf colleagues. And thanks for watching.